supposed to fight. Trying to see what it's like, take me, so I roll the dice. Look up to no one else, but yeah, how was shy. I got real power, Hebrew Israelite.
Chapter 26 and verse 42.
Read up.
Then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac,
right?
And also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. The land also shall be left alone.
Right, so that goes back to the covenant that the Lord made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You also read about that in 1 Kings chapter 8, that if you turn back to the Most High, he's going to turn back into you. Right, start at verse 40.
Verse 40, if they shall confess their iniquity.
It says what?
If they shall confess their iniquity.
So if you confess your sin, you confess your iniquity, you didn't know the right way, read on.
And the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespassed against me.
Right.
And that also they have walked contrary unto me.
Right. If you confess that you've been going off, you've been in different doctrines, you've been lied to, you've been lost. Read on.
And that I also have walked contrary unto them and have brought them into the land of their enemies. If then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity.
Right, because you got to humble yourself. You got to humble yourself. You got to circumcise your heart. You got to be willing to receive this truth. Then what the Most High will do, read on.
Then will I remember my covenant with Jacob.
It says what?
Then will I remember my covenant with Jacob.
Because again, you have certain promises that set up that the Lord can never cast away the Israelites.
What?
If the Lord casts away the Israelites, that means the Lord is a liar, man. That means the sun will have to be destroyed. All hell will have to break loose on the earth. But he's going to remember his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember that there's certain promises that has to be given to the Israelites. And if the Lord don't fulfill those promises, again, that makes the Lord a liar, man. How you doing, sister? You got 1 minute for the word? You believe in God? Yeah. You know your nationality? African American. Now, do you truly believe that you're African American? Are you just a... Now, do you know your purpose on earth? Would you like to learn? Please ask your question. So, since we're here to tell you today that you would, in fact, you would not be African American. Right? African American is a byword that was placed on our people in slavery. Do you know what the word African American means? So, just off bat, we shouldn't call ourselves something that we don't even know what it means. That's like me calling you green and you go with it. If we go with black, although we have different shades of brown. Right. So we have to come back to our God in the last days as the Israelites, keep the commandments of God and return back into him before all hells break loose on the earth.
It's the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12 and verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter.
Right.
Fear God and keep his commandments.
Read that again.
Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man.
Now the whole reason why you was put on the earth, you might say I'm just a person on the earth. I might just be going with the wind. In fact, you have a purpose as a woman. Right? According to the Bible, you are a princess. Israelite, more than likely you will be from the tribe of Judah. Right? This is a holy nation. This is not religion. This is not something you just conform to. No, this is who you are as a person. You're born on the earth as an Israelite. There's nothing you can convert to. So the Lord said the whole duty of man is to fear God and keep his commandments. That's the reason why you was put on this earth. You was put on the earth to serve your creator.
That's right.
Now the next question goes, do you know who your creator is?
I think that...
You say yeah. Oh, nah, you don't?
How you doing, sister?
Oh, yeah, God.
How you doing,
okay,
sister?
So God, like, what about him? Because a lot of people, they say they might know God or they have an idea of God, but the question is, in order to serve your creator, you have to know fully who your creator actually is. And that start by knowing who you are as an individual. So do you know anything about your creator? Nope. Now, it's a difference between what people might think about their creator and who God really actually is. A lot of people, they think that this is God right here. Now, to some people, that might be, you know, we know that's not God. But you have actually people out here, they think Jesus is a white man. They think God is white. They think God is all love. But in order to know your purpose and who you serve, you have to know your creator first. So we're going to get a couple precepts going into who your creator actually is. Now, give me the book of Psalms 47:2 and give me Daniel 7:9. So the creator of the heaven and earth, in the Hebrew, his real name is Yahweh. People say God, people say Jesus, but those are just titles. Anybody can be a God. You have many gods. You have Zeus, you have Poseidon, you have Aphrodite. You have all of these different gods, but guess what? It's only one true God and creator. That's the Most High, Yahweh.
The book of Daniel, chapter 7, verse 9. I beheld to the thrones that were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit.
Right, it said God was sitting on his throne. Another title from him, the Ancient of Days. You know what?
Whose garment was white as snow.
He had an all-white garment on. You know what?
And the hair of his head like the pure wool.
And the what?
And the hair of his head like the pure wool.
It said God, the Father, had an afro. They had damn near an afro. Like the pure wool.
Right.
So what people on the earth have woolly textured hair? That's right. So, I mean, it's only one or two things we can do here. We can say, you know what, that's not the right understanding. Or we could just put two of the two together and say, well, your creator, 9 out of 10, looks just like you. Give me Genesis 1:26. But in America, you pass high school, you're in college, you finish. Okay. So wait, what university you go to? Northwest. Okay, Illinois West. I can hear you. Okay, Illinois Western. That's how you pronounce it. Now, did they teach you this? Okay. What about high school? Now, do you think it's an agenda why they don't teach this? That's right. Now, there's many reasons why they don't want to talk about this. If I put this picture in front of their face and say, hey, who did this? They start getting, we did this before. They start turning red. They get nervous. They say that wasn't me. Just get over it. How do you expect us to get over slavery? But you never want nobody to forget 9/11, though. Never forget 9/11. But slavery, forget that. That's backwards, man.
Right.
Now, the reason why they're not going to teach you this, because this is the world's biggest kept secret. Who the children of God really are. Who are the Israelites in 2022? And who is the God of the Bible? And what God is he? Because everybody knows about the God of the Bible. But they just put their false reality into who they want him to be. Now let's read this, Genesis 1.
The book of Genesis, chapter 1, and verse 26.
Yeah.
I said, let us make man in our image.
What?
Let us make man in our image.
So when God, it's really going into the powers, when they created man, they said, let us make man in our image. Meaning what? The first man on the earth, it wasn't a white man. It's impossible for a white man to be the first one on the planet. Let's go to Genesis 26.
It's the book
All
of right. Genesis, chapter 2, and verse 6. But there went up a mist from the earth, and the waters the whole face of the ground.
Right.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground.
Read that again.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground.
So God created man from the dirt, from the dust. What color is the dust? Brown. So how could it be that when you look up Adam and Eve on Google, they're going to pop up as white men and a white woman. When God just said he formed man of the dust of the ground. So the first beings on his planet were melanated beings. So that knocks out half majority, one-fourth, them there, three-fourths of the so-called white man's philosophy.
Right.
Now, with that being said, God said, let man make us in our image. That means God had to have brown skin. I mean, if he created man in his image, the first men were melanated people. By default, God is a melanated being. Right? But again, this is what you call the lies of America. Now, do you know what Christ looks like? You know what Christ looks like? What's your nationality?
I'm from Italy.
Huh?
Middle East.
Are you from the Middle East? So you don't know what Christ looks like? You from there?
Yeah, I know. Like, slightly.
Give me Revelation.
The book of Revelation.
You don't know it.
Chapter 1 and verse 14.
Right. Yeah.
His head and his hairs were white like wool.
It says what?
His head and his hairs were white like wool.
So it said Christ had white woolly hair. Again, and we just read in Daniel 7, Christ's father got woolly hair. Like father, like son. So the father got woolly hair and Christ got woolly hair.
Right.
You put two and two together, hey. Again, we can't be out here telling fables. We just read in the Bible. Read on.
As white as snow.
He had white hair like snow, but it was woolly. Kind of like what I have right here. Read on.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire.
He had red eyes. Right here, this Jesus looked, he got blue eyes. So somebody's lying here.
Right.
Who is lying? The Bible or the white man? Who do y'all think is lying?
I have a different belief also.
We already know. Read on.
And his feet like unto fine bread.
And his what?
And his feet like unto fine bread.
So it said Christ had feet like brass. What color is brass? Anybody know what color is brass? Brass is like a penny, like a copper. It's brown.
Right.
So if Christ had brown feet, what do you think the rest of his body would be? Brown, right? Read on.
And his feet like unto fine brass.
Right.
As if they burn in a furnace.
As what?
As if they burn in a furnace.
It said Christ is so dark he got burnt in a furnace, man.
Right.
You can't make this up. So again, where did this image come from? And what does that have to do with our people believing in it? Like, these are questions we have to ask ourselves as a community. Be honest, as a community, are we asking ourselves these questions? Or are we focusing on things that don't matter? Like money, drugs, sex.
Right.
We focus on the wrong things when the information in front of our face.
Right.
You could go to Walgreens and get a Bible for what? $10? Say what? 30? Well, hey, that's Walgreens. You could go to a hotel, maybe they got some Bibles in there.
Right.
You could find a Bible on the street somewhere. Somebody just threw it out their window and it's laying on your head. Say, where did this come from? So you can find a Bible like that. Right? But the information is in here. The ways of life is in here. So right. What's your thoughts finding out that Christ is a black man? Are you already knew it?
I mean, like, I have people that are very, like, engaged with themselves and spiritual more than I am. And they always look at me, so
God speaking to you.
I know.
So knowing that God is speaking to you, he's trying to give you hints, information. What are you going to do with it? You going to just keep moving or accept it? Because everybody's not called. Let's go to Matthew 26:16. Believe it or not, this is a blessing to stand up here and listen. Not many people just walk past. We have certain people. They literally see us out here. We talk to them. They see us and they run past
right. The
service of the Lord. Literally.
Right.
They stop right there. They see us. They either turn the other way, they go around, or they might just run past.
Right.
I just thought I was in his way and he was just like standing right there and I was like, what?
Hey, that's how the Most High works.
Right.
Let's bring this up.
It's the book of Matthew, chapter 20, verse 16.
You do.
So the last shall be first. And the first last,
right?
For many be called, but few chosen.
Read that again.
For many be called, but few chosen.
A many called. There's only a select few that's chosen. Everybody can't understand this. they find out Christ is black, man. They can't understand you. We had certain women, they was up here, they said, no, he has to be white. That's what they said.
Facts.
So, that literally happened, what, 2 weeks ago? You know why? Because you got something called Stockholm Syndrome.
Right.
So,
right. The
so-called white man in slavery, they beat down the minds of their people. They drilled it in their head.
Right.
To the point where from generation to generation to generation, they always going to be inclined to their slave master. They always going to love master. That's all they know. And it goes from generation to generation to generation. So Stockholm Syndrome is actually real. So many are called, only a select few chosen. A lot, what are you going to come to find? A lot of people are going to die. And that goes back to who God really is. Let's bring on Psalm 47:2. A lot of people think God is a nice guy. He's love. He's hugs. He'll just forgive anything. When we talk about the God of the Bible, he kills people. Literally, he killed the firstborn of the Egyptians.
Literally.
You heard about Moses in the Red Sea, right? Moses, he split the Red Sea. The Israelites went through. And once the Israelites crossed the other side, the Egyptians, he closed them up and killed them. Now, God, that's all love. Why would he kill the Egyptians? Is God all love? Is God all love? See that? He said God all love. Let's see.
It's the book of Psalms, chapter 47, in verse 2.
Jealousy, right? He has all of these different emotions, but he masters them. Man can't master these. Man gets mad, he might kill somebody.
Right.
Right? The Lord, he has these different emotions as a just balance, but he masters these emotions. So that knocks out that God could be all love. Let's read this.
It's the book of Psalms, chapter 47 and verse 2. For the Lord Most High is terrible.
It says what?
For the Lord Most High is terrible.
So he's a nice guy.
For the Lord Most High is terrible.
Give me Luke 19 and 21. It said the Most High God is terrible. Again, when you read the book of Isaiah chapter 36, the Lord killed 185,000 Assyrians by an angel. That's a lot of people. The same God that literally has people that die on the earth. Somebody might get shot by a straight bullet. Guess what? That's the Most High did that.
Right.
The Lord did that. A baby might die being a miscarriage. Hey, guess what? God did that. But people, they hear that. They so used to Christianity. John 3:16, God loves everybody. God loves the whole world. But when you actually read the Bible for yourself, it says nothing that these people are saying. That's why we can't believe God. We have to read for ourselves. But if you want to hide something from a black man, put it where? In a book. The white man know we not gonna read. That's why he put the greatest informations are in books. We'll rather watch a movie before we read a book. That's all due to institutionalized and nothing but slavery and strongholds that's on our mind.
Right.
Let's bring this up.
It's the book of Luke, chapter 19 and verse 21. For I fear thee, because thou art in us. Austere man.
Read that again.
For I fear thee, because thou art an austere man.
So it said Christ was an austere man. Hey, Christ, he barely smiled, man. If he was on the earth, he'd be like that man that just walk around like Kawhi Leonard, man. He just barely smiled. He barely cracked a smile.
Right.
Because he had a mission he had to do. He had to die for the sins of the nation of Israel. He had to get on the cross. He had to endure the temptation that he was set to. When you understand his truly life, and he was an austere, he didn't play around. Right? Read one.
Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow.
Right, that's it on that. Read this up.
Book of John, chapter 2, verse 13.
Thou
and the Jews' Passover was at hand.
Right, it was Passover, read on.
And Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting.
Right, so Christ is going into the temple. He's finding inside the temple where you're supposed to pray, supposed to give your offering. It's men in there selling. They just doing it what they want to do inside the temple. Let's see if Christ just forgave these men. Read on.
And when he had made a scourge of small cords.
It says what?
And when he had made a scourge of small cords.
Hey, Christ put together a whip, man. He literally put together a scourge, a whip. Read on.
He drove them all out of the temple.
He what?
He drove them all out of the temple.
Meaning, hey, Christ, he snapped, man. He said, what the hell are y'all doing? He put together a whip and he drew those men out. Read on.
And the sheep and the oxen and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the table.
And what?
And overthrew the table.
Read that again.
And overthrew the table.
So Christ was flipping over tables, right? So again, how can Christ be this man? Do he look like he's gonna overthrow a table? Just look at him. He look like he gonna overthrow a table. No, he looks soft, man.
Right.
He look weak. So what we have to do, sister, we have to take out everything we learned in America, and we have to come back to the Bible the right way.
Right.
Now, before we go into something else, I want to address something that you said. Because you said you have friends that's spiritual, correct? What you mean by spirituality? They into rocks, crystals, no? Right, what do you mean by spirituality?
I just heard something like they have a
close
relationship with God.
With God? Okay. And how would you determine your relationship with God? Because everything, believe it or not, it's every scripture, it's literally every answer is predicated in the Bible. It has to be predicated off of precept. So a lot of people say they got a relationship. Yeah, I got a personal relationship with God. You probably heard that before. I got a personal relationship with God. I heard this one woman, she said that at night she talked to God on her bed. She had a conversation with him. So going off what people say versus what the Bible say, you will be surprised how many people be lying. So what would you say you could predicate your relationship with God? Bible should look. If your Bible don't look like this, I mean, have you been putting it to work? So you want to make sure you translate, because it's a spirit behind actually reading these words versus on your phone. And here you remember where the verse at verbatim. You might not exactly remember the verse, but you know what page is on, all from reading out of the book. Like I said, it's a different spirit on it. You open up this book, every time you open up the Bible, Christ, he's literally suffering with you. You spend a one-on-one time with Christ. A lot of people think, oh yeah, I want to spend time with Christ. let me go to the Raising Cane's. No, Christ is not going to sit down with you at Raising Cane's and ask you how you're doing.
Right.
You spend time with Christ every time you open up this book.
Right.
Your mind is the door. Christ is knocking at the door. He's saying, read me. Right? Pray. Pray to me. Fast. Study. It's up to you whether you're going to open up the door or not. A lot of people, they slam the door in Christ's face. They go do something else. They go get on Netflix. They watch TV. But some people, they take advantage. They say, you know what? Hey, I'm finna read. And you start getting happy. You wake up in the morning like, man, hey, I want to read. Right? You getting off on them. You pushing down 80 on the highway. You trying to finish 2 Samuel. Right? You trying to finish the book of Jeremiah. So it's going to take time with that. Nevertheless, give me 1 John chapter 2 and 3. We're going to help you out today. Right? 1 John chapter 2 and verse 3.
It's the book of 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 3.
Give me Psalm chapter 111 and 10. And hold Sirach 21 and 11. So.
And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments.
So, if you can prove, you can see if somebody's lying when they say they know God. It says, and hereby we know that we know him. Read that again from the top.
And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments.
If we what?
If we keep his commandments.
So the only way you know God, you got to be keeping the commandments.
Right.
Read on.
He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments.
Read that part again.
He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments.
How y'all doing, family? Right, so if you say you know God, and you don't keep his commandments, read on.
Is a liar.
Is a what?
Is a liar.
Is a what?
Is a liar.
Read on.
And the truth is not in him.
And the what?
And the truth is not in him.
Right, and the truth not in you. Right? So how y'all doing? We're just bringing out to this sister how you truly know that you know God. So if I would ask, how do y'all know God? Or do y'all believe y'all know him? All right, how do you know God? My family? Okay, what about you?
Give it to the people.
You know, you think you know God?
I know him.
You know, okay, that's a better answer. You know what? Now, let's see what the Bible says. You say you know God by family. Let's see what the Bible says. We're going to get from the
top. Book of 1 John, chapter 2, and verse number 3. And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments.
If we what?
If we keep his commandments.
The only way you could say you truly know who God is, you got to be keeping his commandments.
Right.
Read on.
He that said, I know him.
Because you might say, yeah, I know God. Right? Give me Titus 1 and 16. I know God. Right? We got a one-on-one relationship. Read on.
And keeping not his commandments.
But you're not keeping no commandments. You still smoking, going to the club, you gangbanging, you selling drugs, you getting fast money. I mean, how can you be doing those? You committing adultery. You down. You doing all type of manner of wickedness. How can you say you know God, but you're doing those things? Read on.
Is a liar.
Is a what?
Is a liar.
Read on.
And the truth is not in him.
And that means you a liar. So if you say you know God, but you're not keeping his commandments, you a liar and the truth is not in you. And that goes, let's bring this out before we go to the next question.
It's the book of Titus, chapter 1 and verse 16.
You know,
they profess that they know God.
Right, people profess that they know God. You got pastors, y'all been in church, right? Y'all might think the pastor actually know God. Oh, this must be a man of God. Whole time the pastor, he's robbing y'all of y'all money.
Right.
You got something called a 501(c), I believe, where the government set up these pastors and they actually get money and make money off y'all going to church and putting it into the collection plate.
Right.
But that's information they don't want to bring out, though. Nevertheless, they might say they know God, but yet the pastor committing adultery with the deacon's wife behind closed doors. Right? Deacon Wilson. Read on.
Say, but in works, they deny him.
But in what?
But in works, they deny him.
And this is saying in the world, actions speak louder than words, right? So that's what we learn in this new understanding of the Bible, who God really is. Now, the question would be, what are some commandments? Because the commandments y'all might think y'all know, but how many commandments y'all think it is? Let me ask you guys. 613 laws and commandments in this Bible.
Right.
613. You said what?
I was thinking that's kind of fair, because, like, yes, they have, like, the don't kill, don't steal, don't have sex with others, but, like, throughout the Bible, there are other things. From what I highlighted, like, I have different kind of highlighters in my own Bible. Whenever it's something that kind of, like, I feel personally, like, feel, like, things that you shouldn't go by, I feel like I guess that would be considered a commandment, but without the same.
Right, now that's a good question, because in Deuteronomy, it's commandment all through the whole Bible. So somebody might give a commandment. I might give a commandment to be on time at 6 o'clock. That's a commandment. Now that might not be divinely inspired by the Most High. Nevertheless, men can give commandments as well. So if somebody say don't sit at all with another man's wife, although that's not 10 commandments, that's still a commandment, because it's going to keep you from doing committing adultery. So you have certain commandments and ordinances set up outside of the law. But let me bring this out, Psalms 111:10.
It's the book of Psalms, chapter 111 and verse 10.
Yeah.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
It says what?
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding of all they that do his commandments.
Read that part again.
A good understanding of all they that do his commandments.
That might go into the question is, you might actually read the Bible, but it's hard to be understood. It's Mordecai, right? So trying to find out what a land of fools is. It's Job. Trying to find out these different things. But only way you're going to understand the Bible is if you keep God's commandments. If you don't keep God's commandments, you're going to have a hard time understanding the Bible. That's why certain men, they can't understand the Bible. They're not keeping the commandments. For one, you got to be on the time. You got to be an Israelite. All that. Because the commandments wasn't given to everybody. The commandments was only given to the Israelites. So if you're not an Israelite, you're not going to understand this Bible off back. If you're not on this sign, just forget it. And that's what we have to accept. That's the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible doesn't accept all. Now, give me Deuteronomy 28:15. Right? What y'all live in Chicago? Where y'all live in Chicago? Okay, Harvey. You live in Chicago. So how are we living in Chicago? Or not even in Chicago, across every city in America, are we living the best, or are we in Bible? As a whole, it's popular. Why is that? It gets deeper than greed. You're gonna come to find out the reason why these people on the time living how they living, the blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans, it goes back to them breaking God's commandments. So the same God that gave them commandments, he set up blessings and curses if you keep the commandments and if you don't keep the commandments. A lot of the problems that's going on in our community stem back to the Bible. But we don't do any reading. We don't do any history, no scholastic sources, and we don't do no scholarship to know these things. Now is the time to be able to accept it right now. Got that verse 1.
It's the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and verse 1.
Yeah.
And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God.
Now y'all know about Moses, right? Y'all heard of Moses? Now Moses did what? Right on, y'all know what he did? He split the Red Sea. What else did he do? He didn't murder nobody. He killed, it's a difference between murdering and killing. He freed the Israelites out of slavery.
Right.
Remember he said, hey, let my people, he told Pharaoh, let my people go. So, yeah, Moses was part of the Red Sea, but he freed the Israelites out of captivity. Now, he's given the Israelites commandments. He's saying if you keep these commandments, you listen to your God. Read one.
If thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high.
That the what?
That the Lord thy God will set thee on high.
And we won't be on the bottom.
That the Lord thy God will set thee on high.
The Lord told the Israelites, if you keep my commandments, you're going to be set on high.
Right.
Believe it or not, it was one point in time where we was on high. We had kings. You had King Solomon, King David. You had the princesses of the nation of Israel. We was at high rulership. But guess what? Are we on high? That means we did what? We got it. We broke the commandments. Now, what's some of the punishments for breaking the commandments? Do you know? I mean, the same curses apply even to this day.
Got it.
Well, let's see that's the Bible. It's a lot of curses, but she on fire right now. Read it. Come down to verse 15.
Verse 15. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command in this day.
If we don't listen to these commandments, what's going to happen?
That all these curses.
That what?
That all these curses.
Good things.
That all these curses.
God said curses will come upon you. Now, when you read Deuteronomy chapter 28, which is a beautiful chapter to read, it actually goes into over 43 curses that the Israelites have on them in 2022. Go to verse 46.
Verse 46. And they shall be upon thee for a sign.
Right, for a sign. Just like you see the golden M, you know what that's what? If you see a golden M, we all know what that is, McDonald's. Right? You see a damn a black cookie, you know that with the white filling, you know that's Oreo. So when you see these curses on a Pacific people, hey, and you know that's the Israelites. They gotta be the Israelites. Read on.
And for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever.
And what?
And upon thy seed forever.
Meaning in 2022, the curses will still be on the Israelites because they broke the commandments. Not only that, but they constantly keep breaking the commandments. Right? Now, verse 46.
Verse 46.
Verse 54.
Verse 54.
Now you mentioned greed, right? The love of money. That's a curse for not breaking God, for breaking God's commandments.
So the man that is tender among you and very delicate.
Right, the fellow brethren, like me and this brother. Read on.
His eye shall be evil towards his brother.
His what?
His eye shall be evil toward his brother.
No, we gonna have respect for him.
His eye shall be evil toward his brother.
So God said, okay, you wanna break my commandments? Just like any parent would. You get in trouble at school, might come home, get on punishment. This might make you stand in the corner. You might get a whooping. That's the same way with our God.
Right.
He punishes us if we do wrong.
Break it down.
So God said, guess what? You want to break my commandments? You're going to have an evil eye towards your own brother. What does that mean? We having an evil eye toward each other. We hate each other. What people on the earth literally hate each other? So-called black people. So-called Hispanics as well. Native right. Americans. White man, he's not going down the block saying, hey, where you from? He look you up and down, say, run your pockets. Right? Telling you to check it out in the alley. You go over there, you check it out, then you get robbed, man. That's not happening. They stick together. We the only people that's divided. You probably had a sister come up to you, probably got your hair done, looking good, and she just hit on you for no reason.
Right.
That goes back to the curses in Deuteronomy 28. On.
And toward the wife of his bosom.
And toward the women, the wives. How are we as a nation treating our wives? Are we treating our wives with respect? No. How are we treating our wives? Bad. We just using them for their bodies. Passing them to the bros.
Right.
To the guys. Committing adultery. Treating them as dogs. One point in time, prior to integration, we used to have high respect for our women.
Right.
Then it just went downhill. Well, we broke God's commandments, that's why. Read on.
and towards the remnant of his children.
And toward his children, right? I know y'all probably gotta go, but we just now, it's the good part, right? How are we treating our children? You said what? Yeah, we're treating them like slaves. Hey, go get that first. Go put this in the refrigerator. You're not even teaching your kid, now you just use certain women, they use their kids just to get it down for their taxes. They have more kids so they can get more tax money.
Oh.
They give them the tablet, they say just go in the room. Why they go meet with another man inside the living room? The tablet's not gonna teach them. You have to be a parent. You have to teach your children. You said what? Yeah, actually getting passed down. Right? So, did y'all have y'all fathers in the household? Damn, 2 out of 3. Let's read on.
And towards the remnant of his children, which he shall leave.
Which he shall what?
Which he shall leave.
Are you going to stay in the household?
Which he shall leave.
So it's a curse that the Israelite father, the man, will actually leave his children.
Right.
Once again, you look amongst our people, we're most known for having our fathers leave the household. So all of these stem back to the curses. Now, she says slavery. Let's get straight to the point. Verse 68.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again.
Meaning, God will bring you back into slavery. Because the Israelites never went back into slavery. Right? Well, chiefly, they never went back into Egypt. Right? They went out of Egypt through the promise, through the wilderness, went into the promised land. Exodus 22.
The book of Exodus, chapter 20, verse 2.
Yeah.
I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage.
Out of what?
Out of the house of bondage.
Because the Israelites were slaves in Egypt. Right? Who do you think built the pyramids? People say the Egyptians. But the Egyptians actually had slaves. Anytime somebody is ruling empire-wise, they never build it up themselves. That's what the Babylonian Empire, the Achaemenic Empire, the Romans, they always use slaves to build up their kingdom. Just like with America. Did the white man build up America? Did he build up these buildings? No. Who built up the White House? Slaves. They burnt it down, then they had slaves build up the White House again. So anytime somebody is ruling, keep that in mind. Any empire, they never built it up themselves. They always used the labor of slaves. Which is, I mean, every empire do it. Even the Israelites in the kingdom, they gonna do it. Right? Read on. Verse 68.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
With what?
With ships.
With what?
With ships.
What nation of people went to slavery on ships? Say Africans? Well, the Israelites, well, so-called African-Americans. Believe it or not, it's a difference between the Africans and so-called black people. Well, we actually migrated into Africa. We really from the land of Israel.
Right.
But in 70 AD, fleeing Roman persecution, over a million Jews fled into the west part of Africa. Some fled in to east part of Africa, they fled in north and south. Some of us were still in the homeland. Majority of us fled into West Africa. So again, it's a difference between Africans and so-called black people. Just because you have brown skin or dark skin, that don't make you automatically African.
Right.
The Arabs, they have dark skin. Are they African? What about the East Indians? Right? No, so just because you have dark skin, that don't mean you African.
Right.
Read on. So these people on this side went into slavery. Because you had the Hispanics, they went into slavery under Christopher Columbus and his men. You had found Mayan slave ships. And the Native Americans, they was actually one of the first to go on slavery. Back and forth from America to Spain.
Right.
Right? Read on.
By the way whereof I speak unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again.
Right.
And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies.
Ye shall be what?
And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies.
Hey, God said when you get off those slave ships, you're going to be sold into your enemies. Who was we sold to when we got off those slave ships?
What?
What did God just talk to? Do you believe that? be a hard pill to swallow. The reason why you hesitate, because we've been taught that, hey, we all family. We all a part of the human race. When the God of the Bible said you actually have enemies. Because a friend wouldn't do this to you. A friend wouldn't put a chain around your neck with your woman. Right? They used to rape the slaves. They used to rape the woman. They used to feed our babies to alligators. They used to play hit the nigger baby. You had women on the slave ships. A woman has a cycle every month. They didn't have they didn't give the women tampons. They said, hey, you gotta just bleed. You gotta deal with it. That's, a friend wouldn't do that. So last time I checked, history itself teaches you that these people are not your friends. If anything, they have shown that they're your enemies, and still to this day, they keep showing you that they're your enemies.
Right.
You have Jaden Walker, man. Got shot over 90 times. And you expect me to call these people our friends?
Right.
George Floyd, Breonna Taylor. But yet these people, they are friends. Hey, man. Hey, that, you can use that 40 years ago, 2022. Hey, we passed that. We woke up now.
Right.
So finding this stuff out in the Bible, who is this talking about? All of these things that's happening to the Pacific group of people, it only fits one nation on the earth.
Right.
We know that to be the people of the sun. But what did God call us? That's the whole reason why we out here. Because black is not a nationality. Nowhere, you cannot go to the land of black. No, I'm gonna take a plane ticket to the land of black. That's impossible. There's no nationality. Black is the color of my jacket. Right? Hey, one of my professors in orchestra, one day he said, y'all got to stop calling yourselves black because that's not a nationality. I didn't realize that he was telling the truth until 5 years later. And he was upset. He almost called us a niggers. He said, y'all niggers, y'all calling yourselves black, that's not a nationality. African American, that's not a nationality. He was white. He said that. African American, that's not a nationality. America goes back to the man by the name of Americo Vespucci. He was an Italian map maker that mapped out the Americas in the 1400s. So, in Africa and America, that's two different continents. We're not African. If we are, what country do you come from? It's over 47 countries. You kind of come to find out, our people don't know who they are as a whole. But we're reading that in the Bible, we are the Israelites. Do y'all know who the Israelites are? Deuteronomy 7:6. The Israelites are God's chosen people. God created many races on this earth. He created Chinese people. He created white people. He created Asians, Africans. Out of all of those races, God chose the people on this sign to be his people. Let's read it out of the Bible.
It's the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 7 and verse 6. For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself.
Right, God chose us to be a special people. When you examine this sign, I mean, can anybody do anything like the people in this sign? We dominate everything. Nobody can cook better than us. They're not more intelligent. Hey, a black man invented the traffic light. Half of the stuff that's discovered was discovered by us.
Right.
All of the animals, we're more smarter than them, right? We're faster than them. We're physically, genetically better than them. Right. They can't even stand in the sun. But when we stand in the sun, we glow more. Right. So God is saying we're special people. You know what?
Above all people.
Above what?
Above all people.
No, we all equal.
Above all people.
Y'all believe everybody's on the earth equal?
No.
What about you?
Hey, how you doing, family?
Everybody on the earth equal. Every race equal. No. Now, y'all all said no. Why did y'all say no? Yeah, okay, we get treated differently.
Familiar.
I like that.
believe God could choose one people and say they're better than another people?
What?
Do you, would you believe that if we showed you in the Bible? God, read it again.
It's the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 7, and verse 6.
Yep.
For thou art a holy people, unto the Lord thy God.
Right, pay attention to what he's saying. He said, hey, the Israelites, they're a holy people. You know what I'm saying?
The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
So God said the Israelites are above, they're better than everybody on the face of the earth.
That's right.
What's y'all thoughts? Y'all believe that? Y'all believe that the people on this sign, that as a race, because we all one people, do you believe that these people on this sign is better than every other race on the planet? The Bible said. Not mentally. Why would you say not mentally? Okay, okay, that's reasonable. Absolutely. Now, if we're away from our God, we're gonna be nothing. Which are where we are right now. That's why we are nothing. Nevertheless, when we have our God, what is we keeping His commandments? We doing what we have to be doing. God said, "Hey, there's nobody. It's no race that's like y'all." Y'all believe that? It might be hard, because growing up in America, you were taught everybody's a human. We're all the human race. Nobody's better than another. But the Bible is saying something totally different. So that goes back to the first question. Who do we believe? Do we believe man, or do we believe God? What we have to do is believe God. Because over here in America, we in a westernized mindset. A lot of the things we do is backwards. Versus people over there in the East, this is normal. A lot of stuff that they do over there is normalized. Why in the East, in the West, hey, they say you could be a homosexual. Hey, just, hey, be free. Over there in the East, that wouldn't go. They would probably stone you. So we in this westernized mindset, we have to get this philosophy out of our heads.
Right.
So that being said, we are the Israelites. Before y'all go, we got some commandments we got to go over. This is very important. Now, we mentioned earlier, it's over 613 law and sexual commandments. We're going to show y'all some commandments that y'all might not know are commandments that y'all will have to keep in order to get salvation. Leviticus 11, 3.
It's the book
Leviticus
of,
11, 7.
It's the book of Leviticus, chapter 11 and verse 7.
Yep.
And that's why, though he divide the hoof and be cloven footed.
Y'all know what the swine is? You know what this wine is? It's the pork, it's pig, bacon, pepperoni. Alright? That's the pork. Y'all eat that? No, you eat that. You want to? You want?
Yet he cheweth not the cud. He is unclean to you.
He is what?
He is unclean to you.
You know what?
Of their flesh shall ye not eat.
What God say?
Of their flesh shall ye not eat. And their carcass shall ye not touch. They are unclean to you.
So according to the Bible, it's a sin to eat pork.
Right.
I was never told that at one point in time. When I found that out, I had no other way to accept it. Right? So finding it, what's y'all thoughts finding out that eating pork is a sin? Yeah, that's wild. But God gave us certain animals we can't eat every animal. That's like me just going, I'm digging up an octopus, and I just eat it. Yeah, certain people, yeah, they eat dogs. They eat rats.
Yeah.
How y'all feel about rats? Nasty. That's how God feels about the sport.
Right.
The pig. And even physically, the pig is one of the most filthiest animals on the planet.
Right.
A pig eats anything. They have no sweat glands. They don't sweat. So all of the toxins is in their bodies.
Break it down.
I seen a pig eat another pig before. It was nibbling on it. Pigs eat rats, fish bones. They eat anything. So why would you want to put that inside your body? But we do that. As a punishment, God give us high blood pressure, diabetes, gout,
right.
High cholesterol. Those are all consequences for breaking this one commandment. You're doing. Y'all eat seafood? Barely. Y'all eat seafood? What type of seafood you eat?
Okay. Sure.
You're doing?
verse 9. These shall ye eat of all that are in the water, whatsoever have fins and scales in the waters, in the seas, and in the rivers, them shall ye eat.
So according to the Bible, we can only eat things that got fins and scales.
Right.
If it don't got fins and scales, it's an abomination. So shrimp, crab, lobster, the stuff that's highly, because it's a hidden agenda, believe it or not. The so-called white man, he puts that stuff in our communities, and he push it on our people, and we exalt it. Y'all probably heard of the mukbangs, the mukbangs, with the seafood boils, the woman, she dipping it in there, she eating it up. All of that is promoting sin. The double bacon, baconator cheeseburger, they have on Wendy's, 2 for $4. All of that is promoting sin. Because the more sin we in, sister help me, brother help her up. We got it back. We got a bag for you, sister. All praise to the Most High. So the more sin we in, that's the more we away from our God. Because God does not deal with sin. Alright, so no shrimp, crab, a lot. Y'all willing to do that? No more pork, shrimp, crab, lobster, etc. And y'all want to pay attention because they put pork in anything. Gummy bears, toothpaste.
Right.
Yeah, toothpaste. Anything. Again, this is in the agenda. Their job is to keep from sin as much as they possibly can.
Right.
Put more guns in the community. Put more drugs in the community. Put more pork in anything. It's pork in certain wines. So y'all want to be mindful of that. Nevertheless, that is a commandment. Let's bring this up.
It's the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, and verse 27.
Yeah.
Ye shall not round the corners of your heads, neither shalt thou mar the corners of thy beard.
So according to the Bible, as a man, you can't shave your head bald. Or like Michael Jordan, that would be a sin.
Right.
Yeah. Not only that, as a man, you can't shave your beard. Now, if you can't grow one, okay, that's different. But if you could grow one, you want to chiefly grow out your beard. All right? That's a beard. The definition of it, it's a badge of manly dignity. All right, read on.
Verse 28.
No.
You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead.
Right.
Nor put any marks upon you.
Nor what?
Nor put any marks upon you.
All right, what do y'all think that sounds like? Can't print marks upon
you.
So getting tattoos is actually a sin. Y'all knew that, you know that, right? Y'all knew that. Now, certain brothers up here got tattoos. That's where you have a word that comes into place, which is repentance. So you can actually repent from the sins you didn't know was a sin. One point in time, we didn't know that eating pork was a sin. We asked God to forgive us, we didn't know. Never did it again. Alright? That's what repentance truly is. You don't want to repent for your sins and then you go back and do it again. I mean, you're not truly sorry.
Right.
Nevertheless, that would be a sin according to the Bible. Exodus 20 and 8.
So book of Exodus chapter 20.
Y'all smoke? No? Any type of drugs? Alright. You going?
So book of Exodus chapter 20 and verse number 8.
Yeah.
Remember the Sabbath day.
Says what?
Remember the Sabbath day.
Y'all know what the Sabbath day is? Sabbath. Y'all know what that is?
The day where you do
that. Said what?
It's supposed to be the day that you don't like work. It's the day you get rested off, and you're supposed to praise God the entire day.
Absolutely. The Sabbath day. What we gonna read on? We gonna tell you.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son.
So the Sabbath day is the seventh day of the week, right? It's a day of no work. It's a day of rest. That day is predicated on getting closer, just resting. You might read, you might pray,
right?
Get into some scriptures, watch something educational. So what's the seventh day of the week? You said Sunday. You said what? Sunday? Y'all got a phone, right? So So I want y'all to look on y'all's calendar and see what's the first day of the week. Oh, he got it right here.
See?
Yeah. Right. Sunday is the first day of the week. So if Sunday is the first day of the week, can Sunday be the seventh day of the week and the first day of the week? So if Sunday is the first day of the week, what's the seventh day?
Saturday.
So you see how they put this...
That makes sense.
It makes sense. You see how they put this information in front of our faces, though? They basically tease us with it. Yeah, I know them Negroes, and I'm going to put them, but they put it in front of your face, and we destroy it mentally. Nevertheless, the Sabbath day is when it's Saturday. So actually, right now, you're in a Sabbath day. Back then, they didn't have clocks. Right, they didn't have an Apple Watch. They could tell the time. They predicated the time and the days of when the sun goes down, chiefly when the sun sets. So when the sun sets today, that means we're in the Sabbath. So from Friday sundown to Saturday sundown, that's the biblical Sabbath.
Right.
All right. In it, thou shalt not do any work. You can't do your own pleasures. So if your boss tell you to come in on a Sabbath day, you gotta say, I'm not dealing with that. Now, certain people, they go in, they sin against their God. Nevertheless, y'all want to try the best y'all can to keep these commandments. 1 Timothy 29. We got like two more before y'all, we let y'all do.
The book of 1 Timothy, chapter 2, and verse 9.
Yeah. No. In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel.
And what?
In modest apparel. What? With shamefastness and sobriety. Not with broided hair.
That's it on that. So according to the Bible, women, we're going to get straight to the point, women are supposed to wear dresses. Yes. You say you know that?
I didn't, but I like dresses.
Like dresses, all crazy. Certain women, they don't like. Certain women, they don't like dresses. And that can be hard because we raised up that we're not taught this before. Taught pants is the way. Pants, they come out to like the 1950s, 60s. And it's an agenda on pants. The pants is, get a black woman a pants, she runs the household now. She's the man in the relationship. That's why you have a lot of women out here, they saying, I don't need a man. I could do it. Y'all watch that movie, I Could Do All Bad by Myself, by Tyler Perry. But it's a movie. She thought she could do bad all by herself. Until the end of the movie, she ended up getting married. So it's a hidden agenda why they want y'all to wear these pants.
Right.
It's a spirit on pants. Next you know, you put on pants, now you looking back in the mirror. Do I look good? Because when he look at a woman with that stuff on, some of our women, they wear bikinis. It's 30 degrees outside. They wearing that crop top. They showing their body.
Right.
But they cold though. They cold, but you wearing that. That don't make sense. Right? So as a Israelite, because our women are princesses, you want to cover up your body. What you have, that's chiefly to your husband. You don't want to show that out to every man.
At all.
Because men are dogs, believe it or not. Men see you like that. You think a man, they see you in unmodest apparel, they see you not in a dress, not covered up. You think a man really wants you for your mind? No. He wants you straight for your body.
Right.
And once he get what he want, he's on to the next one.
Right.
And to avoid that as well, just cover up. A man will respect you way more. There's already studies. They did studies at Princeton University, right? Jamestown. They did these different studies versus a woman that put on modest apparel and a woman that has one. Modest apparel, one has a dress. There's studies showing that men actually treat women different. They look at them different. When they did studies, they said when a man see a woman with no clothes on, they mind go dog, beast, animal. They get in animal mode. Versus a woman, when it's she dressed up, she covered up, they mind is a little bit more simmer and calm down.
Right.
And you don't really see a woman like that. You see a woman with a dress and you're like, dang, who is this? She's wearing a dress and she read the Bible and she believe in God. They gonna be like, what the hell is this? right? They approach you different. Instead of saying, hey, yo, check it out, man. Right? Let me talk to you real fast. Let me get your number. They gonna say, hey, how you doing? What's your name? Yeah, they might stutter. You said what?
Start stuttering.
Yeah, they gonna start stuttering. So that's the commandment, believe it or not. So the goal is to get as much dresses as you can and put away those pants. Put away all the harlot. We're going with this harlot ideas. It's harlot clothing. Booty shorts, that's for harlots. That's for women that got no respect. Boy, that's for shame. Women that's just, they have no sobriety and shame factor. Right. But a real righteous woman will put those things on. It's the truth. So, you know what I'm saying? It's never too late to change. That's the main goal. All right, it's never too late to change. Now, y'all got any questions about the Bible in general? Any questions, anything about life?
Book of Deuteronomy.
There's nothing wrong with being confident, but they're confident in the wrong things. Nobody cares about how good you look on the outside as a woman. And that applies for a man. Give me Proverbs 31 and verse 30. So you being confident in your body, that has nothing to do with you breaking God's commandments. Because honestly, that's what you're doing at the end of the day. Now, women that's like that, if we want to be realistic, the women that do that, those are the women that's most insecure about themselves. That's the reason why they do that, to get attention. Speaking off just research and just experience, those be the most women that be the most insecure. So let's bring out Deuteronomy 23 and 17.
Book of Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse 17. There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel.
There shall what?
There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel.
Hey, God said, Israelite, nah, she can't be no whore. She's better than that, right? She's a princess, right? Read on.
Nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel.
Right, so there can't be no harlots in the nation of Israel. Believe it or not, most of our women ain't harlots. Now, if I would ask you, right, how do you know a police officer is a police officer? His uniform. What about a firefighter? His uniform. What about a harlot? A harlot, a whore. How can you tell that a woman is a whore? That too, majority, the first thing you're gonna tell is by her. You said what?
I was saying that your point was based off what she wears. It's
kind of
how
perceived. Absolutely. Give me side right, 19 to 29. We got a couple more. I know y'all gotta go.
I got a pre-sort too.
Turn. Right? Sirach 19.
It's the book of Sirach, chapter 19, verse 29. A man may be known by his looks.
It says what?
A man may be known by his looks.
And the Lord said, you can tell a man what type of man he is, what type of woman she is by their looks. Read on.
And one that hath understanding by his countenance.
You can tell, this man is a man of understanding. He gotta be a wise man. You can tell off the actions that they shoot for it. You know what?
One that hath understanding by his countenance when thou meetest him. A man's attire and excessive laughter and gait shoot what he is.
Right, so you can tell somebody what type of person he is by their attire. And what he's doing. If you see a man that's always laughing, he always cracking jokes. He's never serious. You know what type of man that man is. He's a goofy.
Right.
Right? He's a goofball. Right? He has no moral. He just laughs all the time. If you see a woman, she always dressed in modest. She always on her phone, on TikTok. She always twerking. I mean, it's not hard to tell what type of woman she is. Now, sometimes that might not be the case. It might be insecurities. She might not be getting that attention at home. So guess what? She might not be getting that attention from her father. So she go out in the street seeking that attention from different men, which leads to her downfall. So I would just say and recommend, just keep the commandments. Brush with that. That's, did I clear up? Did I answer your question?
Thy sons and daughters.
Sure. You got a question?
Not that I remember.
2 minutes of the war.
Go to side right, 26.
Go to side right.
Proverbs chapter 31 and verse 30.
Right.
Favor is deceitful and beauty is vain.
And what?
And beauty, beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised.
So according to the Bible, God doesn't care how good you look on the outer appearance.
Right.
Yeah, beautiful. It's probably beautiful women in this world. Right? But how is your spirit? Does your spirit match the same energy as your outward appearance? You can be beautiful all you want. Have a nice body, but you don't even believe in God. You don't even believe his creator.
Right.
You don't have no type of morals. You didn't slept with 25 men. This stuff happens.
Right.
Right? This woman out here, hey, they slept with 50 men before. Yeah. In high school. This is true.
Facts.
So it's not necessarily on your outward appearance. God, he looketh on your spirit. He looketh on your heart to see if you pure or you sincere or not.
Look at Sirach chapter 25 and verse 17. The wickedness of a woman changeth her face and darkeneth her countenance like sackcloth.
So a wicked, you could tell the wicked woman by her countenance, her face. Wicked woman, sometimes if you spiritual enough on this and you have that discernment, you could look at a woman and tell that she's off.
Right.
You can see them bags underneath her eyes. You can smell the cigarette breath on her.
Right.
What's going on, man? How you feeling? You smooth?
Yeah.
You gotta come check us out, man.
What's your number again?
Take it down. Hey, somebody get this man. Give him the channel. All right. Nevertheless. All right. Speaking. All right. All right. So, what's three things that y'all learned today? Up here. Y'all know y'all nationality?
Yeah.
That's the bonus pick. What's your nationality?
Oh, like, looking all y'all here?
I mean, that's predicated off the Bible. So we didn't just come out here, mama just make up a sign, put the Israelites on there, smack it on the poster board. That's predicated off a chapter in the Bible, chiefly Genesis chapter 49 and Deuteronomy chapter 33.
And so
that's predicated off of the Bible. Through history, archaeological evidence, and Bible prophecy.
Right.
So according, that would be your true nationality. So you might, we all are Israelites, but you have different tribes. So up here, you had a tribe of Judah will be the so-called African Americans. If you see somebody that's Puerto Rican, they will be an Israelite too, but they will be from the tribe of Ephraim. Mexican, they will be from the tribe of Issachar. You got different tribes, but they make up one nation. If that makes sense. So your nationality will be an Israelite. Now that tribe, that's up to your father, whoever your father is, because your father carries the sperm or the seed. So you are what your father is. And this is the truth. This is going viral. Now y'all heard about Kanye West.
Y'all didn't hear about that controversy. Kyrie, they came out and said we the Israelites. Y'all never heard that? Hey, they had the information going out.
So, y'all got any questions though? Y'all be on YouTube. Yeah, y'all gotta check out our YouTube channel. It's more edification. Y'all got Bibles?
Yeah.
Alright, what y'all wanna do? Y'all wanna get y'all the Bible and start reading. Let's go to Revelation 3. Reading is very important. And it's a lot. It's a lot of things that we don't really know that's, it gets deep. In all the way to the name of God, who God truly is. Because God, like we bring out to the sisters, we go back to the Hebrew, which is the oldest language. God, his real name is Yahweh. Right? Because many people are gods. Right? His true name is Yahweh. His son's name, what people call it, Jesus Christ, his real name is Yahweh Shah, which means in a Hebrew, he delivers or he saves. Because he's coming back a second time to save his people. All this brings up.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 3.
No.
Blessed is he that read it.
It says what?
Blessed is he that read it.
So God said, hey, you blessed when you read.
Right.
As a community, do we really read?
No, we don't read.
Right? If you ask us, name one book that we read, we just scratch our head. And when you go into the statistics, they say over 84% of the children in elementary, African American, can barely, they don't even have comprehension skills. They don't know how to read. 84% of them. But they know how to get on that video game, though. They know how to get on TikTok. They know every song on the radio, but they don't know how to read. So seeing that, that's a problem. What we have to do and fix is we have to go back. We have to start reading. And that's reading the Bible also. Read on.
Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep the things which are written therein, when the time is at hand.
And you, not only do you want to read, because anybody could just read the Bible. You want to keep those things that are written therein. So the Bible tell you not to, if you read and thou shalt not commit adultery, don't just read over, thou shalt not commit adultery, then the next day, you will commit adultery. Thou, you can't smoke weed, then you go out and go smoke weed somewhere. So whatever you read and you want to apply that to yourself. And that's going to, your life is going to change. Right? Your life going to do a whole 180 turn. Right? So, I mean, that's pretty much the basics. We the Israelites, we got to keep the commandments of God.
Right.
You know, we got to repent before all hell breaks loose.
Right.
So believe it or not, yeah, Christ, he's coming back in his second coming. He's coming back to kill people.
Right.
Right. Y'all believe that Christ is coming back to kill people? Y'all probably never heard of that.
Like
right?
The Jehovah Witnesses.
You said what?
Like the Jehovah Witnesses.
What about them?
Don't they believe that? Christ will come back again.
Well, a lot of people believe that Christ is coming back. Christianity teaches that. Jehovah Witness, Catholicism. But they teach that Christ is coming back to save everybody. That's not in the Bible. How can everybody be saved? Everybody be saved. That's not realistic. Let's go to Luke 19:27. And Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 15. Christ is coming back to kill sinners. So if you sin in while Christ returns, no respect to persons, you're going to get killed. And that's what we were saying earlier, right? We have to get this image of Christ out of our head, right? Christ is not a white man. According to the Bible, Christ is a so-called black man. According to the Bible, Christ from the tribe of Judah.
Right?
So let's bring this up.
Book of Isaiah, chapter 66, and verse 15. For behold, the Lord will come with fire.
Says what?
For behold, the Lord will come with fire.
Because the first time God destroyed the earth, he did it with what? Anybody know? Water. That's right. With Noah's ark, he destroyed the earth by water. The second time is going to be by fire. That's why y'all have something called the lake of fire. Y'all heard about that? The lake of fire. You ever heard about that? Well, a lake of fire is not going to be, it's not hell. Hell is not real. You just go underground, the devil will be poking you with a fork. Saying, I knew he's coming down here. No, that's not real. And he got a nice long tail. That's them from Greek mythology.
Right.
The lake of fire is on this sign right here. Right? You're gonna have ICBM missiles sent over here from Russia, from North Korea, from China, and it's gonna destroy America for all of their sins that they have done. And the oppression which they had towards the children of Israel. You have people, literally, they're going to be burning. They're going to be melting through the missiles.
Yeah.
Right? So Christ is coming back with fire. You know what?
And with his chariots like a whirlwind to render his anger with fury. And.
What happened? Right? And his chariots. The chariots are the so-called, they're the so-called UFOs. People talk about the UFOs. What are those things flying? According to the Bible, these are chariots. The angels of God are the vehicles to the Most High God. Right? The angels are in these vehicles.
Right.
That's why they put this stuff in the movies. Y'all watch Independence Day? Y'all never watched that movie, Independence Day? Y'all seen the movies, though, with the alien invasions? Y'all ever seen those type of movies, TV shows? Well, they put this stuff on these movies for a reason, because they read the Bible. They know this stuff is going to happen.
Right.
Only thing is, it's not aliens that's in those.
And by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh.
Right.
And the slain of the Lord shall be many.
And a what?
And the slain of the Lord shall be many.
No, he's coming back to save people.
And the slain of the Lord shall be many.
Hey, a lot of people going to die. Why? Due to their sins.
Right.
A lot of people, the Lord is killing. Let's read on.
They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree, in the midst, eating swine's flesh.
Eating what?
Eating swine's flesh.
So it says if you caught eating pig when God comes back, when the Lord comes back, read on.
And the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together.
Shall what?
Shall be consumed together.
See that? So if you eating abominable foods and you went to sin when Christ returns, you're gonna be destroyed. Again, Christianity doesn't teach that. That's this. Christianity doesn't teach that God kills anybody. Bring this out, Isaiah.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 63 and verse 1. Who is this that cometh from Edom with thy garments from
Bozrah,
this that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength, I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save.
Right, so Isaiah the prophet, he's seeing an end-up vision of Christ coming back. And he's saying, who is this man that's going to the land of Edom, that's going into Bozrah? This man is glorious in his apparel. Read on.
Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel?
He said, because Christ is coming back with an all-white garment on. He's going to have an all-white garment which represents his righteousness.
Right.
Now he's saying, hold on. Why is you red in your apparel? Read on.
And thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine fat.
Right.
I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in my anger, and trample them in my fury.
Right.
And their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments.
And their what?
And their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments.
Read that again.
And their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments.
Hold on. Why is Christ? My question to these Christian pastors, these top men, which we confronted them, but they don't have any answers. Why is Christ saying my garment, my all-white garment, is going to have blood on it?
It's going to come back to kill.
Kill who?
People that broke the
commandments. That's right. People that broke the commandments. And ultimately, the other nations. Right. So, hey, Christ coming back with blood on his garment. He coming back with an all-white garment. It's going to be blood on it. He's going to have a sword in this and going to chop people's head off. Hey, this is what the Bible say.
Right.
Y'all got to be okay.
Thank you.
All right. Look into the information, though. All right. So, hey, I mean, people might not like it, but, hey, we didn't write the Bible, man. We just read it.
Right.
We didn't write the Bible. We just read it.
So you say you don't have any questions?
I don't know how to like this today. As far as like your reading, have you like read the book from start to finish? Do you bounce around? Do you do both? Like as far as
Well, give me 1 Corinthians 14 and 4. Let's answer that out of the Bible. Now, just like any novel, nobody will pick up a Stephen King's novel and start from the back and read it to the front. So, just like with the Bible, you want to read it front to back. There's a lot of information that you could get from reading the Bible front to back. Because you don't want to jump into, not saying you, but yeah, certain people, the first thing they read is the book of Revelation. They jump straight into the book of Revelation. They jump straight into Matthew, into the Gospels. But they don't know what, they can't understand it because they don't know they don't even know about the rebuilding period of Ezra and Nehemiah. They read about who is Abraham. Well, you don't know who he is because you haven't read it from the beginning. So I would recommend, right? It's nothing really scriptural. I would just recommend personally starting from front to back. Now, when you get a little bit, certain brothers in the truth, they're a little bit more skilled. They seasoned. So they could read 2 books at one time, right? But reading 2 books at one time, that might not be profitable for somebody that's just coming in or that's just trying to learn. That's how to begin to stage. So I would recommend reading it from front to back just so you could get that nice, firm foundation, if that makes sense.
The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 14 and verse 40.
Read it.
Let all things be done decently and in order.
It says what?
Let all things be done decently and in order.
And this is manifold. You don't want to let all hell break loose when you read. I say you read, you jump into Revelation, trying to find out what is this great dragon. Then you just throw the Bible down the stairs saying, I can't understand this. So you want to start from the beginning. Hey, read. Hey, even in a... Hey, the whole Bible is deep.
Huh.
You might think Genesis. A lot of brothers think Genesis, they think that's milk. Right? Because some brothers, Genesis might be milk. Hey, Genesis get deep.
Huh.
Right? I don't want to go into in depth because I don't want to stray you away, but Genesis get deep. You read about Adam and Eve. Believe it or not, Adam and Eve, we just going to say it, they wasn't the only people on the earth. You believe that? One point of time, I believe so. Give me Genesis 5:3. We're going to show you something. Just a little secret. It's impossible for Adam and Eve to be on the only people on the earth. They say Adam ate a bit of apple. In the Bible, it never says an apple. It says fruit. So that's what reading comes in. When you read it for yourself, you start to find out how many things is left out and what other people say versus what's really in there. Nowhere in the Bible does it say Adam bit an apple, he was in sin.
Right.
It don't even say apple in there. So Adam, it's a lot. Let's bring it up.
It's the book of Genesis chapter 5 and verse 3. And Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own likeness after his image and called his name Seth. And the days of Adam.
Start at verse 1.
Verse 1. This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female. Male and female created he them.
It says what?
Male and female created he them.
So God, are this controversy of God just putting Adam on the earth and creating woman? I mean, that's not realistic. Adam, believe it or not, let's go to Genesis 2 and 26. Adam had to have parents. I mean, God could do whatever he wants, but again, God deals with reality. He deals with things realistically. So it said God created man and female. He didn't just create man, and then the eighth day he created a female. No, when he created man and female. Read on.
Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam.
And what?
And called their name Adam.
It says, and called their name Adam. So at one point in time, everybody was called Adam.
Right.
You had some called the Adamites.
Right.
Right? Everybody was called Adam at one point in time, but you had the chosen Adam. Nevertheless, we don't want to get too deep, but Genesis get deep. Let's bring this up. 2 and 24.
Book of Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh.
See that? So Adam said a man is supposed to leave his father and his mother. How would Adam know that? So Adam would have to have parents. Otherwise, why would Adam say a man is supposed to leave his father and his mother and cleave to his wife if he didn't have no parents? So it's a lot of, what you call, you have some called allegories, riddles. You know what a simile, metaphors, etc. is. It's secrets in this Bible. That's why everybody can't understand this thing. So again, I would just recommend front to back. And I would recommend fasting. Do you fast as well? You know what fasting is? It's a little bit, that's one of the ordinances. It's a little bit more than eating and drinking. You're basically afflicting yourself to God so you could be heard on high a little bit more, so the Most High can see you. It's chiefly from sundown to sundown. Fasting will help as well. Like I said, praying will help. It's even a certain way how to pray. Like, how do you pray? You said what? But like, do you get on your knees, do you stand up?
Hey, brothers, hear the words of the Lord, brothers.
Okay. So what do you say when you pray? Good, because now the Most High, and believe it or not, Lord answer your prayers. Because in order for you to receive this knowledge, like I said, everybody can receive this. So believe it or not, God heard your prayers, that he's giving you that opportunity now. You just have to see it. So give me 1 Timothy 2:8. Believe it or not, it's a certain way how to pray. And give me 1 Corinthians 11:3.
So book of 1 Timothy.
Do you have a husband? No. Okay. Now I would just ask him, because it's a order and a rank. You said what?
20, 50
years old. Oh no, it's okay. I mean, certain women, they have husbands at 20.
Right.
Believe it or not, that's another controversial topic. But let's bring this up first.
It's book of 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8.
You know?
I will therefore that men pray everywhere.
It says what?
I will therefore that men pray everywhere.
Read that again.
I would therefore that men pray everywhere.
Hey, Paul said, I would that men pray everywhere. So there's nothing wrong with praying in the shower. Hey, you might be at Walmart, you might have to duck off and go to the bathroom and pray. You might be on a plane, you might be praying, right? So you might be praying, and you could pray everywhere.
Right.
Chiefly, let's go to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6.
Well,
right? You want to pray in your closet. And when it says closet, that means in a secret place where it's just you and a father. You don't want to just go out in front of everybody and just start praying. That's not biblical. Explain yourself.
It's the book of Matthew, chapter 6, and verse number 6.
No.
But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet.
Do what?
Enter into thy closet.
You know what?
And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly.
So you pray to him in secret, and God gonna reward you openly.
Right.
And you had a Lord's Prayer, right? You can say the Lord's Prayer, but ultimately you want to pray in the Hebrew tongue because the Hebrew is stronger than English.
Right.
At one point in time, everybody on the earth spoke. You know about the Tower of Babel, right? Where it was a big tower they tried to build up to God, and God confused their language. At one point in time, everybody on the earth used to speak Hebrew. But as time went on, man progressed, you had different languages brought about. So you want to chiefly pray in the Hebrew tongue. You'll get that in the prologue to Sirach. Bring this up.
It's the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3. But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ.
It says what?
I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ.
So it's a hierarchy. Right? You had a Most High, the Father. You have His Son, Christ. You have man, woman, and children. Right? So the head, I have a head as a man. My head is Christ. I can't go straightly to the Father. No, I have to go through Christ. It's an order, you know what?
And the head of the woman is the man.
Right?
And the head of Christ is God.
And what?
And the head of Christ is God.
So even Christ has a head. Right? Christ's head is God. Christ has to, believe it or not, Christ has to submit himself into the Father. You heard about the Trinity doctrine, right? That God and Jesus is the same. You ever heard that? You heard that before. That's something you want to stay away from because script, absolutely they weren't. So Christ has to submit himself into the Father. You know what?
Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head.
So if I was to pray with my head covered, I pray with a snapback on, I will be dishonoring my head. My head is Christ. So when I pray as a man, I have to make sure my head is uncovered, showing reverence and respect. Read on.
But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered, dishonoreth her head.
Guess what?
Dishonoreth her head.
So as a woman, when you pray, you want to make sure you have your head covered. Because if not, you will be dishonoring your head, which will be your husband. Now, since you don't have a husband, by default, your head is Christ. Next in line until you get a husband or a man. So you want to pray. Next time you pray, you want to make sure your head covered. Make sure you get on your knees. You want to prepare. You don't want to just pray and then you just blot out anything. You come in before the Most High God, you want to present yourself in a respectful manner. Now, let's go to John 9 and 31. Give me Exodus 20 and 16.
This is the book of John, chapter 9 and verse 31. Now we know that God heareth not sinners.
It says what?
Now we know that God heareth not sinners.
So according to the Bible, God doesn't hear sinners, right? So if you're in sin, the Lord, he's not going to hear your prayers. He only hears the prayers of righteous women and men. So you want to keep that in mind as well. Go on.
But if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth.
So if you're a worshiper, you're doing the will of the Father, you're keeping the commandments, the Most High is going to hear your prayer in a matter of, in a manner of time. All right? Let's bring this up.
Prologue?
Yeah, bring that out first.
All right, this is a prologue of the wisdom of Yahweh Shai, the son of Sirach. It reads, wherefore, let me entreat you to read it with favor and attention, and support us wherein we may seem to come short of some words,
right,
which we have labored to interpret. For the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into another tongue have not the same force.
Read that again.
For the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into another tongue have not the same force.
So the Hebrew and the English, the Hebrew is stronger than English by far. The Hebrew is stronger than any language. So you might be praying to God in English. Yeah, he might still hear you, but if you praying in Hebrew, is way more powerful and it's way more strong.
That's right.
So instead of dear Heavenly Father, dear God in Jesus, da 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 da, and you want to say Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, I mean, it just, it feels more powerful seeing that this is the name of the Father and the name of the Son, Yahweh and Yahushua. All
right.
Now we got one more. Exodus 22 and 16.
This book of Exodus, chapter 22, verse 16.
No.
And if a man entice a maid that is not betrothed.
Right, if a man entice a maid that's not betrothed, let's say he has a fine interest in a woman. Right? She don't belong to another man. You don't
want and lie with her.
And what?
And lie with her.
And what?
And lie with her.
You don't want?
He shall surely endow her to be his wife.
He shall what?
He shall surely endow her to be his wife.
Are you gonna teach these brothers real fast? Read that again.
And if a man entice a maid that is not betrothed and lie with her, he shall surely endow her to be his wife.
So I know you said earlier, I caught you say you said sex before marriage. According to the Bible, sex is marriage. According to the Bible, sex is marriage. So the moment you lay down with a man, that becomes your husband. The moment a man lays down with a woman, that becomes his wife. Do that make sense? You can say, if it don't make sense, let me know so I can clarify it. Yeah, even Esau has something called soul ties. So they even say a woman, let's say if a woman is a virgin and she sleeps with a man, and they, let's say they don't work out, she sleep with another man, she's still emotionally inclined to the first man that she slept with. So even biologically, I mean, it goes in depth, showing you that the moment you lay down with a man, vice versa, a man lay down with a woman, that becomes your husband, right? She becomes your wife, and y'all are with each other for the rest of y'all lives until one of y'all dies or somebody commits to the priest. So, knowing that, what's your thoughts on that? What does that teach you as a woman?
What'd she say?
That's the world. So the world, they're gonna make fun of you. It was two females. One of the women got on the other female because she wasn't, because she still had her virginity. She said, girl, you haven't gave that up yet? You tripped. And she went to go freak off. Right? So that's beautiful and that's good. Nevertheless, that does tell you to, hey, watch who you lay down with. And again, majority of our women don't follow that
at all.
They get enticed by their lust. They go do it. So that's good. You should aspire to be married. He said, give me Hebrews 13:4. Give me Sirach 7:25. Another brother, give me 1 Timothy 5:14. The Lord said, be fruitful and multiply. And as a woman, one of the reasons why you were created is to reproduce. So you should aspire to be married. We know there's a lot of wicked men out here, but you have, we want to get you a righteous man of the Lord. A man that's keeping the commandments of the Most High. He knows his nationality, and he's subconsciously aware of what's going on. Read this up.
Book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verse number 4.
Read it out.
Marriage is honorable in all.
It says what?
Marriage is honorable in all.
Read on.
And the bed undefiled.
So a God say marriage is honorable. It's beautiful when a man and a woman on one accord, they both believe in God, they both keeping the commandments, they both serving the Most High on one accord. Hey, that's beautiful. There's nothing more beautiful than that. Let's go to Sirach 25:1. Real fast.
This is the book of Sirach, chapter 25 and verse 1.
Look it out.
And it reads, in three things, I was beautified and stood up beautiful both before God and men.
Right, so Sai Rice saying, hey, it's three things. I was beautified. I seen this, man. I was like, this is beautiful. Read on.
The unity of brethren.
Right, when brothers get together. Read on.
The love of neighbors.
Right.
A man and a wife that agree together.
A what?
A man and a wife that agree together.
So, hey, the Lord sees a man and a wife that agree together. He say, hey, that's beautiful. Hey, that's why God created women. To reproduce, right? Adam can do it by himself. He had to create Eve. Right. So I know it can be hard. Be patient. Never make haste. And the Most High in due season, he's going to send the right man to be able to guide you in righteousness. Now, seeing that you don't have a father to be able to show, because chiefly your father would sit you down, he would tell you these things. Did he show you this? Like, did he go over this with you? Like, it's a sincere question. No? Okay. Now, since your father didn't do that, now the Most High, the Heavenly Father, got to step in now. Now he got to show you.
Right.
The way he show you is through the Bible. Right? He's not going to sit you down and tell you, hey, watch out for that. Watch out for these men. These men are not men that are not sincere. No, you have to read. You got to acquire that by reading.
Right.
Let's read it up.
The book of Sirach, chapter 7 and verse 5.
Bro.
Seven, verse 25. And it reads, Mary, thy daughter, and so shalt thou have performed a weighty matter, but give her to a man of understanding.
Read that from the top.
Marry thy daughter, and so shalt thou have performed a weighty matter.
So it's beautiful for a woman to be married. Now in the ancient world, the fathers would marry off their daughters.
Right.
Women nowadays, they're not going to their fathers. They just they hook up with a man, and it is what it is.
Right.
No, the father would have to say so. Okay, you want this man? No, I don't think you should be with him. That's not happening. That's how the fathers will operate in the ancient world. You know what?
But give her to a man of understanding.
But what?
But give her to a man of understanding.
Or a nigga.
But give her to a man of understanding.
So the father's not giving his daughter to a drug dealer.
Right.
Right.
A man with a 2022 Charger, a 392 Hellcat, and he sells drugs. No, he's not doing that. He's going to give his daughter to a man of understanding.
Right.
A man that, okay, I know for sure when my daughter's in this man's hands, hey, everything's going to be okay. He knows the Bible. He's a man of God. He's a man of prayer. Hey, that's how it was being ran. Now everything is faulty because we don't have our fathers in the house. So nevertheless, this should be your mindset as a woman. Not only that, if you have an older brother, you have an older uncle, etc. Right? You know what I'm saying? You want to cheekily bring that to them. Authority, get a say so. Now, 1 Timothy 5:14.
It's the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 5 and verse 14.
Bro.
I would therefore that the younger woman marry.
It says what?
I would therefore that the younger woman marry.
So since you're younger, again, you should aspire to be married. You know what I'm saying? That's beautiful if you want to get married one day. A lot of the younger women, they don't want to be married. They want to have one night stands. They want to live it up. They want to go to the club. They want to turn up. They want to twerk.
Right.
You want to marry while you're young. What happens in our community, the women, they have fun through their 20s, late 20s, early 20s, teenagers. Them, they're early 30s still. Then they want to wait till they're 50 to settle down. Then I want to see. I think Lil' Kim said that, right? She said she just told the women, hey, have fun while y'all young. Then when y'all get older, hey, then get married. By the time, I mean, you slugged out now. Your body is worn out. Your children are going to be all jammed up when they come out. A younger woman, biologically, she's more fertile. So she able to bear children like that smoothly.
Right.
Read on.
Bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully.
Right. You know what?
For some are already turned aside after Satan.
For what?
For some are already turned aside after Satan.
Because the majority of these women, Satan already got them. What do you think the odds? How many women you think the first thing they wake up, they do when they get up in the morning is pray? How many women you really think do that? Not a lot. A lot of women, first thing they do, they get on their phone. They go to the bathroom, they turn on the TV. It's rare that you will find a woman, first thing she get up do, she pray and she read.
Right.
And she study in the scriptures. That's all she into, the Bible. She not, nothing else interests her but the word of God. So a lot of these women, the spiritual demons Satan already got them and enticed and entrapped them up and jammed them up. So you seeing that, you want to be able to be circumspect and say, I can't be like one of those women. Again, all the answers is in the scriptures. Nevertheless, that's chiefly how to go about it. Right, really too much on that. You got any more questions? This one? Yeah, that's okay, dude. Yeah, that's okay. You want to make sure you get the Apocrypha, too. This was originally in the King James, authorized by the King James, but the Apocrypha is 14 books that they took out of the Bible. So the Bible got multiple books that was taken out by the Protestant church in the 1800s. So you want to make sure you get an Apocrypha as well, because it's stuff that was already inside the Bible, but they took it out. So you want to make sure you grab this. It's a lot of gems in there. Right? It's a lot of gems in there. Right? You got Sirach in there. It's a lot of games. So you got any more questions? Anything else? Hey, brothers. So y'all believe that what he said?
Yeah.
What's y'all thoughts?
I don't know.
You said what? Make a lot of sense, right? So y'all know why we got into this predicament.
Book of Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 15.
Yeah. No.
But it shall come to pass if thou will not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee.
So the reason why we going through these things is because the curses of Deuteronomy 28. Right now, with those curses being in effect, all of this stuff that's happening to us is because we broke the commandments of God. If we didn't break God's commandments, none of this stuff would happen to us in the first place. If we weren't selling drugs, we wasn't gang banging, smoking weed, going to the club, seeing how many women we could get on, hey, we would have never went into slavery. So the best thing to do is to keep the commandments of God. All right, again, this brother, he's gonna come up here and show you what commandments we need to be keeping and expounding more on Deuteronomy the 28th chapter. All right.